Thus saith the Lord, cursed is the man who trusts in man and makes flesh his strength, whose heart departs from the Lord. For he shall be like a shrub in the desert, and shall not see when good comes, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in the salt land which is not inhabited. Blessed is the man who trusts in the Lord, and whose hope is the Lord. For he shall be like a tree planted by the waters, which spread out its roots by the river, and will not fear when heat comes. Will you please rise as we sing our hymn this morning, our first hymn? I love to tell the story.
I love to tell the story of unseen things above, of Jesus and his glory, of Jesus and his love. I love to tell the story because I know it's true. It satisfies my longings as nothing else can do. I love to tell the story. 'Tis pleasant to repeat what seems each time I tell it. Tell the story, for some have never heard the message of salvation from God's own holy word. I love to tell the story, will be my theme in glory, to tell the old, old story of Jesus and
with me. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, how wonderful it is to be here in your house this morning. How wonderful it is that we have a God who is the one and only true God of all the universe. I thank you so much that you are not a counterfeit God with a plagiarized and contradicting book, but that you are the one and only true God who created everything. How blessed we truly are to be chosen by you, to be truly special in all the universe. Come sit with us this morning and fill this place with your holy presence. Hear our worship and our song. Feel and measure our hearts and our commitment. Help us to be strong and committed and dedicated to you, our God, and to our Lord Jesus Christ, who gave himself willingly for each of us, that we might be made sinless and spotless and white as snow before you and have everlasting life in heaven. Help us to learn to share the love you give to us with others so that we might grow in spirit and in truth. Come in to our hearts and help us to be the people you desire us to be. Teach us to love and to care for one another. Open our understanding so that we might have the full richness of this life. Accept our prayer for it's in the name of your Son and our precious Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, that we pray. Amen. You may be seated as we create in me a clean heart. Responsive reading this morning comes from Psalms 93, 1 through 5. Jehovah reigneth, he is clothed with majesty.
The Lord is clothed with strength, wherewith he hath girded himself.
The world also is established, that it cannot be moved. Jehovah reigneth. This is the Lord Jesus Christ. He is clothed with majesty. This is a psalm that will really have meaning when he comes to reign on this earth. As we see history unfolding before us, Bible history and prophecy, all rebellious opposition will be broken down. Every knee will bend. And all those who have opposed God will be dethroned on this earth. This psalm is written to impress upon the reader that the church, that Christ is king and that he rules. We are seeing so much going on in the world today where there is struggle in Israel. And I think that we'll get with that in a little bit as I show how that comes directly out of prophecy. But Jesus is the king. We're seeing all this turmoil in the world because the world doesn't want that. So they try to destroy the Jews, thinking that if they should be able to do that, Christ will not return. They're fighting over this piece of Israel, the only place on the planet where their God has deeded the land, that it has been journalized in the Bible. It's the only place on the planet where God has given a piece of land to any specific tribe or nation. Jesus is king, and when he returns, he will put a swift end to the rebellion of the world, and every knee will bow. I don't care if you're Xi from China. I don't care if you're Biden or Putin or Trump or anybody else. Those people are going to bow to the Lord Jesus Christ. When we are in all of this world and in all of this turmoil, we should understand that our Lord, the Lord that we serve, has power over everything and everyone. All of the kingdoms of this world are going to pass away. Because when Jesus comes, he's going to come at a time when Israel is the most desperate, which we are seeing happen pretty closely. And we're going to see him come in majesty. That is, a majesty that is beyond the capabilities of anything on this planet. Everyone is going to know it's the Lord Jesus Christ, because he's going to come in the majesty of light, pure light. He is going to shine, and the world is going to know it's not capable of producing such a thing. The world and the world are set, the verse tells us. They are fixed, and they cannot be moved, neither can the will of our Father. God is trying to tell us that everything that is written in Scripture is fixed, just as this world and this planet revolve around the sun and the moon revolves around us, that it is set and it can't be undone. And that is just as set as everything that written in the Bible. We are seeing all that lay out before our very eyes. We live in an amazing time. This is a psalm that is set to music to make us dance. We are supposed to be full of joy when the Lord comes. There will be great fear before Christ comes, but when he returns, there will be dancing in the streets as they danced after they crossed the Red Sea with Moses, as they sang and danced with King David, as they were singing and dancing in the desert Saturday, October 7th. When Jesus returns this time to the earth, he is coming at a time just like what we are seeing now, these days after October 7th. Maybe it is this time where there is no peace in Israel and war and enemies loom from every corner where Israel is surrounded. There is no help to come except from the rightful Lord and King. The verse goes on to say, "The floods have lifted up, O Lord. The floods have lifted up their voice. The floods lift up their waves." This verse has generally either been ignored or it has been misinterpreted or not interpreted at all. But as we have seen on our TVs, if you have watched any of the news this past week, and especially these last couple of days, that you've seen the oceans of people protesting and calling for the annihilation of all Jews, and that is most evident. And it came to me as I was studying this verse that as I prayed for guidance in preparing this verse the other day, after watching the tidal wave of people protesting against Israel, literally an ocean of humanity crying out to kill Jews. It's exactly what this verse says. Yet I have seen no ocean or mass of humanity crying out for Hamas to release any of the hostages. There is no ocean of voices crying out to release the U.S. hostages. Instead, they gather to cry out against Israel, who was attacked on a Jewish holy day, at peace, dancing in the desert. I believe that this flood of voices represents the tidal wave of anti-Semitism we are presently for the first time ever witnessing from every major city around the globe. Today, from every country as the book of Revelation speaks of, there will be civil unrest like no other time, and there will be a tidal wave of voices crying out against Israel from every nation on the planet. The verse goes on, "The Lord on high is mightier than the noise of many waters, yea, than the mighty waves of the sea." When the Lord returns, only he will be able to silence the tidal wave of anti-Semitism and anger against the Jews. But this only happens by war, where the Lord of armies rides in with his legions and destroys all those who stand against Israel. But it is at a time when nearly all hope for the Jews is lost. Is that this time? We are soon to find out. The born again will not be here to be part of those who lose hope. The verse finishes with a promise. "Thy testimonies are very sure. Holiness becomes thine house, O Lord, forever." This verse 5 affirms that the prophecies are absolutely true and will happen, meaning they will come true exactly as they are written. Jesus, as Lord and King, will win, and he will reestablish the house and throne and royal line of David upon the throne over the entire world, because he has quieted or put an end to the waves, the oceans of voices, or of opposition, as he sits upon that throne to rule the whole earth from Jerusalem. At that time, the bride will be called down from where we have been safely kept upon the rapture until after the wedding, where we are called down to Jerusalem to partake of the wedding feast. Remember, in Jewish tradition and the story of the wise and foolish virgins, the groom came to the wedding feast at a different time, not together with the bride. The virgins had to wait for the groom to come. I think this speaks of the 7 years of tribulation, where there will be a separation between us and our Lord as he prepares the earth for our entry to the feast, where he will make everything safe for us to leave heaven and come join him upon his throne, where he will then rule this planet and every remaining nation and people and we will rule with our Lord. The Lord will dismiss to the lake of fire those foolish ones who did not come prepared with salvation. He will say to them, "I never knew you. Depart from me. You may not come into the wedding feast." Many will surrender, but they will be left outside of Jerusalem and not be partakers of that feast. It always amazes me, as it has happened several times, that the psalm or the morning scripture reading, which has not been taken out of order to fit the occasion, falls exactly at the precise correct time to coincide with what is going on in the world around us. This has happened several times. We have, for the past 3 or 4 years, been systematically reading through every psalm, every Sunday, the psalm, without skipping around. I'm not finding a psalm to fit the occasion. Just look through the past years. It has taken us some time to come to Psalm 93. And I believe God has brought this psalm to light and us to this psalm at this exact time when it speaks precisely to the conditions of the world around us. I believe that we find ourselves here by God's design to encourage you in these troubled times, that our Lord of armies is in charge after all. He is giving us the outline of what will happen in advance to ease our pain and our worries, to give us comfort knowing what will happen. These verses should give you comfort knowing Christ knows exactly what will and is happening, and he is prepared for it. He will have victory, and he will protect all of those who are his. That you can be sure of. We're living in a world where the oceans of voices are crying out for Israel to stop, when they are mostly crying out evil, vile hatred for Israel and for all Jews to be killed. When Christ comes, you can be sure he will not be swayed by the sea of voices trying to get him to stop or cease fire. That will come about when there is only and finally complete capitulation, complete surrender. And it will take a terror and tremendous toll, a terrible and tremendous toll on the world, because the world will refuse to surrender their will. What will happen here in the U.S., you can already see the beginnings of it in every major city and on every college campus. Civil rest that will bring our government to a position of impotence, I believe, because of this growing tidal wave of anti-Semitism. Just as we pulled out of Afghanistan and have waffled into Ukraine, the cry and civil unrest here will bring the government to a standstill while the rest of the world wages war against Israel. Will that be before the next election? It could be. Will we have a Speaker of the House of Representatives? Maybe not. There has been some question about why there was such a breakdown in the intelligence gathering mechanism of the most sophisticated countries in the world. How could that possibly happen? I will tell you that. As I told you last week, I told you 3 years ago that 3 years after the peace treaty, this Abrahamic Accord, was signed, it would end with war against Israel after 3 years. Because, not because I have any special line, but because the Bible says so in Daniel. It is a marker for the end times, to make us watchful for the rapture, the coming of Christ to remove the true believers left here on earth. This happening, this terrible act of terrorism against Israel, had to happen, so God clearly closed the eyes and ears and minds to discovery. There could be no other explanation. The Mossad, the CIA, the MI6 or 7 are all too good at this sort of thing these days to have missed it, unless God insisted they missed it. After all, he is still in control. You are witnessing the Bible come to life before your very eyes, like in the time that was, has never been before. Jesus told his disciples that every stone of Herod's beautiful temple and city would be torn down. No one believed Jesus at the time. They mocked him and kind of just shrugged their shoulders. But just 40 short years later, Jesus' words came true exactly as he told them it would. The fact that no one was believing it didn't make a difference. It didn't matter to God or the Lord. The fact that no one believed didn't change God's plan and its inevitability. Just as today, just because everyone in the world is crying out in a sea of humanity, "Give us Barabbas," it won't change a thing. Our memory verse this morning comes from Matthew 8:20. Jesus said unto him, "The foxes have hold, and the birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man hath not where to lay his head." Matthew 8:20. I praise him this morning. Get the kids out and get them ready, because we're going to speak the truth. I want you to know this every day when you go to school, when you live at home, when you talk to mom and dad. Speak the truth. That's important.
Sometimes it's hard to tell the truth each day. Sometimes a lie is easier to say, but God wants us pure, with a heart just like his, living a life of love, joy, and peace. We will speak the truth. Tell a lie. heart to tell the truth each day. Sometimes a lie is easier to say, but God wants us pure with our hearts just like His.
You kids know that. We're supposed to speak the truth. And good morning to everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. I just saw the sun a minute ago, but it's kind of hid behind the clouds again. But it's just great to be here. And want to let you know how to get in touch with us, 814-967-3628. Please call me or write me if you need anything at P.O. Box 41, Titusville. I want to make sure we let you know that we have Bible study Wednesday nights at 7 p.m. And we will be here this week as well. I got a call this week. It's interesting because the Allegheny News Talk Sports Network, I guess, is no longer in operation. They've switched over to WUZZ, W-U-Z-Z, and they've changed a couple of the channels. And so a gentleman from Meadville called me and said, what's going to happen to your program? And I'm glad that somebody would call, even though they didn't call during the week or any other time to let me know that they were listening, but to complain that they were changing, and he wanted to know how to listen to us. So this morning was the first morning. We're on at 8:30 on the WUZZ network now, not ants anymore. We're on 97.9. And then out of Meadville, the channel changes to 104.5. We're not on 100.7 anymore. We're still out of Titusville, 103.7, and we're in Mercer County at 99.3. So we're still on Talk Erie at 105.9. So we're getting a little bit bigger footprint in the area, but we're on at 8:30 that time, and 9:30 out of Talk Erie. All right. I'm going to go to our prayer request at the end of the service this morning, because we need thee every hour.
I need.
as you turn in your Bibles to Daniel 12, Luke 21, Jeremiah 30, I just want to say I appreciate everyone who watches and listens to our program and supports us in prayer or in any other way. Daniel 12, 14, Luke 21, 9 through 11, Jeremiah 31 through 11. The days are coming. But thou, O Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book, even to the time of the end. Many shall run to and fro, and knowledge shall be increased. I put this together because I think this is where we are, and it actually fits with our responsive reading this morning about the oceans of people that we're seeing in protest. This is an important verse about the end times. As a sign of the time of the end when Jesus will return, knowledge will greatly increase, the Bible tells us. What is going on in the world today? Surely, since the invention of the computer, knowledge has steadily and greatly increased. But something more than that will happen to bring that had brought this to Daniel's attention and to his pen. Supposedly to our attention as well at the correct time. Could this verse be signal about artificial intelligence, AI, coming at lightning speed any day now? We should see an explosion of artificial intelligence headed our way. Will it be brought in and intervene in all the wars and rumors of wars around the world? We don't know yet. Luke 21, 9 through 11 tells us, when you hear of wars and insurrections, do not be terrified, for these things must take place first, but the end will not follow immediately. Then Jesus said to them, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. Insurrections are civil unrest, as we are now witnessing around the globe like never before. Scripture tells us that in the end times we will see great civil unrest, wars and rumors of war, insurrections going on. In the world, there is war all over the place, and where there is no war, there is rumors of war. Those things have happened, but to the born again, God is telling us, do not be afraid, for these are signs. So, who are those signs for? They are signs to the church, not to the world. They won't listen, the world. The world will be deaf, dumb, and blind to biblical prophecy, just like it was to the events of Saturday, October 7th. The warning is for you, the born again, those who believe and are looking. Why are we given the signs to look for? To see and to understand, so that we won't be afraid and tremble in our houses and our beds, because truly we are in a time where we see much trembling. Well, yes, but not that only, so that we also will be afraid of the coming of our Lord, that terrifying day. We shouldn't be afraid of the world because we are already in Jesus. But because we are already in Jesus, we should be afraid of his coming to the world to find us that we are lazy and inactive, that we have stopped worshiping, and that the religion he died to bring us is impotent upon this planet. Because we are chasing after the things of this world rather than chasing after the things of heaven. As I have said a couple times, I warned you 3 years ago that exactly this was going to happen 3 years later. After the accord was signed. I don't know anyone who was telling you this. The world attempting to bring peace has brought death and destruction, rape, murder, and war instead. Now, I'm not saying I have any special or secret line to God. What I am telling you is that it is all right here in the Bible. Right before us, to be discerned if we would only get into the Bible and study to be approved as we are instructed by Christ. So the next shoe to drop is what is coming next, because we find ourselves already in history. We are presently in history. We're in the middle of Bible prophecy. At this point, at where Bible prophecy joins us in Jeremiah 30, 1 through 11. The Lord spoke his word to Jeremiah. He said, "This is what the Lord God of Israel says. Write in a book everything that I tell you. The days are coming, declares the Lord, when I will bring my people Israel and Judah back from captivity. I will bring them back to the land that I gave their ancestors, and they will take possession of it." This is where we are today, and the world hates it. Israel is the only place on the entire planet, as I have said, with a deed to its possession. This land was deeded to Israel by God. No other nation on this planet can make such an argument. So Satan and the world want to destroy Israel for it. Continuing in our verse, this is the message that the Lord spoke about Israel and Judah. This is what the Lord says. We hear cries of fear, cries of panic, not cries of peace. Ask now and see. Can a man give birth to a child? Why then do I see every strong man holding his stomach in pain like a woman giving birth to a child? Why has every face turned pale? How terrible that day will be. There will be no other day like it. It will be a time of calamity for the descendants of Jacob. If you've watched any television, you will find that there are men that have had to go in and find those bodies and those people, tortured, burned, pregnant women with their bellies cut open, their heads cut off, the babies cut in half. And they have grabbed their bellies in disgust, in throwing up, and in pain. And I think that that verse speaks specifically to what is happening now. I believe that this verse is well speaking about the incidents of October 7th. The descendants of Jacob live in southern Israel. That is where the atrocity happened. But I also believe that the Lord is speaking about a day out in the future as well, when Israel will be completely surrounded by its enemies and cut off. For the next part speaks to that. But they will be rescued from it, says the Lord of armies. On that day, declares the Lord of armies, I will break the yokes of your necks and tear off your ropes. Foreigners will no longer make you serve them. You will serve the Lord your God and David your king. I will establish him for you. So don't be fooled. This whole thing is not about any other captivity and return. This is a specific time when Christ returns as king and sits upon the throne of David, as the verse says. As the verse, and God will establish him there for you. That means that it is future tense. Maybe it is today's tense as we watch this unfold before our very eyes. Continuing verse 10, don't be afraid, my servant Jacob, declares the Lord. Don't be terrified, Israel. I am going to rescue you from a faraway place. I am going to rescue your descendants from where they are captives. The descendants of Jacob will again have peace and security, and no one will frighten them. I am with you, and I will rescue you, declares the Lord. I will completely destroy all the nations where I scattered you, but I will not completely destroy you. I will correct you with justice. I won't let you go entirely unpunished. From many places around the world, I am hearing from the young Jewish students and citizens that they are crying and screaming out that they are afraid. I have often wondered what the Lord was going to do to shake the United States, to shake the Jewish population out of the United States. And I think we're seeing that before our eyes as we see this amount of anti-Semitism going on around us. But soon they won't be afraid. From Matthew 24:30-35, we read, then the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky. All the people on earth will cry in agony when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds in the sky with power and great glory. He will, or majesty, as we just read in Psalms, he will set out his angels with a loud trumpet call, and from every direction under the sky, they will gather those whom God has chosen. Learn from the story of the fig tree. When its branches become tender and it sprouts leaves, you know that summer is near. In the same way, when you see all these things, you know that he is near at the door. I can guarantee this truth. This generation, listen to this promise. This generation will not disappear until all these things take place. The earth and the heavens will disappear, but my words will never disappear, reaffirming the psalm that we just read. Is this that generation? Truly, Israel is a tender nation who have just started to sprout. Had all this occurred before the Iron Dome became active just a few short years ago, Israel would already be defeated. Israel has begun to sprout, but God won't let them become so powerful that they will never need the Lord. Time passes, but God's words will never disappear. Matthew 24:12, and because there will be more and more lawlessness, most people's love will grow cold, Scripture tells us. How can anything be more accurately put about the times we are living in right now than this? It's amazing. There is lawlessness and civil unrest at every corner, in every town, coming through our TVs as we watch looters grab armfuls of products from helpless stores, and while helpless employees are made to watch on, while lawmakers make laws to protect the looters rather than the stores and those helpless workers. And most people's love have grown cold. So what's to happen in the future? And again, we must turn to prophecy in Daniel 7:25. He will speak against the Most High God, oppress the holy people of the Most High, and plan to change the appointed times and laws. The holy people will be handed over to him for a time, times and a half of a time. This is the period of the last days, the time, I believe, that begins the tribulation. He that speaks against the Most High, of course, is the Antichrist. If you study this with other prophecies, as well as Revelation 12 and 13, about the time of the eagle's wings protecting Israel, you can see that all of this unfold. Remember, I told you Trump would not be reelected in 2020 or any other time because this period had emptied and ended. Trump, President of the United States, the eagle's wings had kept Israel safe, held like no other person, emperor, empire, or nation has ever before or will ever again, as I believe Scripture tells us will happen at the end times. When I told you that this Scripture, along with Revelation 12 and 13, speak of this time, this three-year period after Trump, where the great king, Trump, and his assistant Kushner, an important Jewish person, bring an historic peace to Israel on September 15th by the Abrahamic Accord. That peace treaty, the Bible says, would last for only 3 years and then be violently broken when Israel was the most vulnerable, believing they had attained peace and were dancing in the desert, totally unprepared. That ended with this attack 3 years later, on October 7th, 2023. So, what happens next? After the 3 years of a misguided peace, the Bible tells us next is the half period, a half of a year, 6 months. I believe Israel will still be embroiled in this war with Hamas and probably Hezbollah. Then there will come an abomination of desolation, as Daniel tells us. Daniel 12:11. From the time the daily burnt offering is taken away and the disgusting thing that causes destruction is set up, there will be 1,290 days. So if you do the math, that's exactly 3.5 years, 42 months. Most prophecy. People think this has something to do with the temple in Jerusalem. But remember, time is meaningless to God. Many believe that this already has happened when Titus the Roman destroyed the temple. But I disagree, as I often do. The original desolation happened when Titus desecrated and destroyed the temple in 70 AD, that's for sure. But we are no longer in that dispensation, or rather time of history. We are in the here and now, the time of the church, the time of Christ. Christ has died and the temple has been desecrated by Islam for the past nearly 1400 years. So therefore, I believe that this desecration is about Christianity, with Christ as Lord and King not having anything to do with the old legal system that Jesus died to remove us from, which hindered us from being saved. Remember, we cannot be saved under the law. So there is going to be this desecration. The temple has been desecrated and has nothing to do with the church whatsoever. We are not part of the old Jewish system. I have also grave doubts that our Lord, our God, will sit on a desecrated throne. I think that Israel will be a city that is above the old Jerusalem, and he will sit there. So, what do I believe happens in 6 months, in this half a year period, this time, this half time? Well, I want you to count the months. When is that? I happened to think about that at the last minute. So from October, when this happened, to November is one. November to December is two. December to January is three. January to February is four. February to March is five. And March to April is six. So what happens around April 6th, 6 months from now, in our current time period? If you guessed Easter, you are correct. Easter is on Sunday, April 9th in 2024. Friday, that is Good Friday, is exactly 6 months from what happened on October 7th, Good Friday. And that, again, as Scripture told us, happened in the land of Judah, in southern Israel. Jesus died on Friday. He rose again 3 days later on Sunday. I am looking for something to happen during that time, meaning this time between Good Friday, April 7th, and Easter, April 9th. Something probably coming out of Rome, as Scripture tells us, maybe out of the Vatican itself. Something around that time, because we can't be specific, but something that should happen a half a year from this ending of the Abraham Accord. Something that greatly and directly challenges Christ as head of the church. Can you see that coming with everybody in a sea, ocean of people as they swarm around the communities and they sing and holler and dance towards the destruction of Israel? It becomes a desecration and an abomination of our Christianity. Or is it a desecration and abomination of the church? We don't know. Well, at the same time, Israel is at war and the U.S. is made impotent. And this may be the forewarning, the precursor that brings Christ to call every believer to come join him in the clouds, when, at that time, the real war begins. The Bible tells us just before the end times, there will be an enormous increase in human knowledge. Is this when AI comes online and the AI intelligence grows at lightning speed? But Matthew tells us that no one knows when that day or hour will come. Even the angels in heaven and the Son don't know. Only the Father knows. We're supposed to know. We should know. Because we're given the time and a half. We are given those things so that we should know, so that we should be prepared. But we shouldn't look for the exact moment and the exact time. But we should be prepared for that because we have been given that as a signal. And that includes me. I don't know the hour or the day. But we are instructed to and are supposed to know the time about which we are living, the signs of them. We are to be watchmen, knowing that a thief will break in. We don't know the exact day or the exact hour, but we are given ample warning about the signs of the time. I believe we are in them right at this very moment, and we should be watching, and we should be preparing. And most of all, we should be spreading the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, harvesting the fields just as the wheat farmer. If you've ever seen wheat farmers out west when the wheat is golden and ready to harvest and they're trying to get every glance, every beam of sun into their crop, and they see the black clouds rising on the harvest, they run out to grab all the people that they can get, they grab their equipment, they run out to the fields, and they start harvesting without stopping. Lights going all night, trucks running back and forth, and they don't stop harvesting until the crop is in. That's what we should be doing now. That's what this time is calling us. We are told these things in the Bible so that we know what our place is and what we're supposed to do, and also so we know not to be afraid. None of this should make us fearful. It should make us be ready to be dancing in the streets. Because when our Lord comes, will we fall on our knees? Or will we sing glory to our Lord? The time is at hand. And are we harvesting? Are you harvesting? Or are you disbelieving still? Are you still caught up in the stuff that's going on and still disbelieving? Just a couple weeks ago, we had peace in the Middle East. And all the talking heads were talking about Saudi Arabia signing the peace, and it was going to be great peace in the Middle East. And if you've listened to me over the years, you know that I said, only Jesus Christ can bring peace. And then, almost like the flick of a switch, that ended. And it's not only the Middle East that's in war, but the whole world is caught up in this. Don't be fearful. If you know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, start getting your Bible. Start getting out. Start making sure everyone knows. Because I believe the time is short. We should let our Lord and our God know that we believe them, and we follow them, and we give up our spirits to allow our God and our Lord to have their own way. If you have prayer requests this morning, if you have praises, God working miracles and wonderful things in your life, it's hard to get us to a point where we're excited about some of the things, but we should be always have praises for our Lord and for all the things that he does for us. Do you have a praise for the Lord that you should lift up this morning as we get ready to go to the Lord in prayer and close the service? And we want to make sure that in the sanctuary, we have prayer for Linda as she gets ready to go to some procedures this week. And Sharon is coughing, and we want to keep her in prayer as well. If you have prayers as well, this time to lift them up to our Lord Jesus Christ, to lay them before the throne of grace as we come boldly before the throne of grace. Dear most gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you for all that you have done for us. We thank you for watching over us and guiding us and leading us. We ask you to be with each and every one of our prayers. I pray that we have a long list of people who are praying for other people who need to be saved, who need healing, who need your hand upon them. Watch over us and help us to be the people that we need to be. Guide us and lead us. And be with all of those who do not yet know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. I pray that you send the Holy Spirit to them, to convict them that they need to know salvation before the end becomes too late, before the groom walks into the wedding feast and closes the door and tells the people, "You came unprepared. You didn't come with salvation. I never knew you. You must depart from me." I pray that those days will come soon, but I pray for people who do not yet know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, because the consequence of not knowing Christ is going to be a terrible day. Help us to be the people that we need to be. Bring us each back to church to worship our Lord and Savior and our God. Keep us safe and healthy and happy these days and close to you in all we do and all we say. In Jesus' precious name and for his sake we pray. Amen. Polly, would you take our offering?
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him all creatures here below. Praise him above ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
And since I already said the benediction, close it. Dismissed. Have a wonderful, wonderful week.